San Quentin Prison, California, 3 weeks after the bloodiest event in its history.
Tension here at San Quentin, it's something you can't explain. When you have tension, it's something you can feel. You can actually walk in here and feel it, if there's tension.
We have the Ku Klux Klan and the Black Panthers who would like to get at each other's throat and who use every opportunity to inflame racial tensions.
Well, we have different groups in the institutions such as Nazis, Black Panthers.
Nazis? What are they?
Well, they're just a group of fellows. Now, I don't know. Some of them are pretty good people that I have to deal with. Now, whether you want to call them radicals or not, I don't know. But being a Nazi, I would say radical.
They'd be divided in racial groups. You know, the Mexicans be on one side, and all the brothers be on one side, all the whites be on another side. You know, and it's constant tension, you know, in this yard. It's constant tension in this institution. I imagine it's constant tension in every institution around the world, you know, but I believe more so here. Like I said before, I don't exactly know why, you know. It looks like just the smallest incident, the simplest thing can touch off a race riot or some kind of riot, you know. If when a white sticks a brother, then it's automatic retaliation.
Violence is no stranger to prison life. Prisoners live on top of each other 24 hours a day. There's no ghetto or white suburb for them to go home to. The authorities accept this state of undeclared war. Some guards actively encourage it. If one inmate is attacking another, at least the guard isn't getting hurt. What was new and alarming was that inmates should suddenly turn their violence against their keepers.
Since March, we've been having problems racial-wise. It was blacks against whites and vice versa. Now it's almost seems like everybody's against what they call the greenies, which means the officers in green uniforms. So we're always looking out behind our back all the time.
Tension had been mounting here at San Quentin Prison for several months. With encouragement from black militants and radical lawyers outside, more and more black inmates were becoming politicized and organized inside the prison walls. These activities culminated in an event which, in the long term, may be judged more important than Attica, simply because of the death of one man. Here, on Saturday, August the 21st, three white guards and two white trustee prisoners were murdered, and one black prisoner, George Jackson, was shot in circumstances which are, to say the least, mysterious.
I love him like a brother, you know, and I respect him for what he, you know, what he believed in. That was a change, you know. I definitely believe in a change. There's got to be a change.
Well, George Jackson was a smart man as far as being smart. But he was a belligerent radical, as far as I'm concerned. I've had dealings with the man. And if he was, I feel this way, if he was trying to help his people, let me try and think of how to put this. If he was trying to help his people, the black people that are straight people and are never looking for trouble outside of their radicals. George Jackson was a radical, period. This is my estimation of the man, although he was smart. But George Jackson, like I say, I've had dealings with him, and I wouldn't give you 2 cents for a carload like him.
Life was poor. We were very poor. We lived in cold water flat. But it was nice. It looked like a little dollhouse on the inside.
How was that?
Because I painted it and fixed it up nice, kept it clean. And everybody was always surprised when they came in our flat by the way it looked, you know, the outside and where it was without the way it looked inside.
When you say you were poor, how poor were you?
Very poor. We used to live, oh, back in the 40s. My husband would make probably $19 or $20 a week. We would usually always buy baby food first. And if there's anything left, we'd buy something for ourselves. If it wasn't, we wouldn't. That's how poor we were.
Did George ever talk to you about the fact that he was black and you were black and that you were a poor family? Did he ever discuss that with you?
I used to talk to them about it. I used to tell them that they were black. And in order to achieve, they'd have to be twice as good as white. I said, if you're twice as good as the white in school, then maybe you'll make something. Yes, that's what I used to tell them. It was the truth. So why hide it from them?
Jackson's political education was aided by one of those strange liberal quirks in California law, which allows a prisoner mental, if not physical, freedom. Any book, revolutionary or otherwise, that the prisoner requires, the prison authorities are bound to let him have.
Isn't one of the ironies that you can lock someone up for a long period of time and yet give him access to any revolutionary material he requires? Thereby, don't you create a revolutionary?
If we put a man in a cell, and by his nature of his acting out, we are required to keep him in his cell, then we feed him all the revolutionary works, and George Jackson had, I guess, 100 or more revolutionary works. Of course, it gives him nothing else to think about. He's not concerned about bettering himself. He's only looking forward to the day when he can get out and become a true revolutionary.
You guys want to step on this chair?
Not only do prisoners have time to read and study revolution, they also have time to organize and fashion the instruments of guerrilla warfare, the bomb, the knife, and the gun. San Quentin has its own counter-insurgency troops.
Strip. Take your pants off. See your shoes?
These are the kind of weapons they're looking for. Zip guns, knuckle dusters, knives and hatchets. They may be crude, but they kill. For the past year, under the tightest and most sophisticated security conditions in America, Angela Davis has been held in the Marin County Jail, waiting for her trial proper to begin. She had not been allowed to give any television interviews.
Our attempts to film an interview with Angela Davis are perhaps the best possible indication of the kind of fear and tension that surrounds her. After prolonged haggling, permission was granted for the interview to be shot through a soundproof, bulletproof screen. I was to be on one side and Angela Davis was to be on the other. Our only means of communication was to be via the telephone.
At last, the authorities gave way and allowed me behind the screen, but the film crew had to stay on the other side.
Angela's, some of the letters that George wrote you are not revolutionary tracts, but they're love letters in almost the romantic sense. How close were you to George?
Well, we were very close, both as revolutionary comrades and also in a personal sense.
How in a personal sense? How did you get to know each other?
The first time I met him was on the occasion of one of the court appearances in Salinas, California. I had not really expected the scene that confronted me when I walked into that courtroom and sat down and saw coming into the courtroom three black men who were chained and shackled. I had never seen black men before with chains all over their bodies. It was certainly reminiscent of slavery. And in spite of the fact that they were completely suppressed in a physical sense, you could see from the attitude and their demeanor when they entered the courtroom that they were not for a moment going to resign themselves to that situation, that they were that they had a very profound fighting spirit, and it was that which really affected me very strongly.
Can you understand what life was like for George Jackson in prison now that you yourself have spent almost a year in prison yourself?
It's very difficult to understand, I think, for anyone who hasn't experienced what George experienced personally. I know that, you know, although I am in jail myself, certainly it is not identical to the type of experience that George had, 7 years in solitary confinement. For a long time, did not have access to the kinds of books that he wanted to continue his development. He did not have access to people on the outside, because the only individuals permitted to visit him were his family. And then also the fact that precisely because George refused to be the type of person that the prison system is designed to create, he experienced a surplus repression. He experienced a repression that was much, much more intense than anything I think I have individually gone through.
Three weeks ago, on August the 21st, at San Quentin Prison, George Jackson was killed, 2 days before his trial was finally due to begin. This is what the prison authorities say happened on that day. Stephen Bingham, a radical young attorney, came to visit Jackson and passed through a metal detector like this, which bleeped. His briefcase was searched and found to contain a tape recorder. Hidden inside it, say the authorities, was a gun like this. Bingham was also alleged to have smuggled in an Afro wig, under which Jackson was to hide the gun to get it back to his cell. Jackson then walked through this door, so the authorities say, across the front courtyard of the prison and back to his cell in this block. Exactly what happened inside that block in the next 20 minutes, only a few people know, and most of them are dead. What we do know is that 25 prisoners were released. Then three white guards and two white inmates were killed. Two of them had bullet wounds. All of them had their throats cut, with a razor blade embedded in a toothbrush. The alarm was sounded. Jackson ran out of the block and back across the courtyard, gun in hand. The authorities say he was shot twice, in the legs and through the head. He fell here and died, making for this wall 50 yards away and 25 feet high. That's the official version of Jackson's death. It raises several questions.
Who killed George Jackson?
I don't know. I don't know by name, and I wouldn't tell you if I did, because this would be a matter, again, that goes before the courts. But he was killed by rifle fire from one of our armed posts, and if I were to anticipate your next question as to why was he killed, any man with a pistol in his hand running for the wall at this institution, if he was not shot at and either harmed or killed, the officer in the tower would be not doing his duty. That's exactly what he is there for.
I raise my children to love people. I raise them to mingle in American society, but American society didn't want them.
Do you think that George's death was inevitable, given the kind of things he was saying and writing?
They couldn't let him live. Wouldn't be any way possible for them to let him live. He's a black man. They're afraid that people will begin to listen. And they had. People all over the world had begun to listen to George. And I certainly know the people in this country had. That's the reason why they framed him to be murdered the way he was. to try to discredit everything that he had said, to try to paint him as an insane maniac, an animal. That was the reason for it.
What were Jackson's aims?
Well, I think Jackson's aims have been clearly stated. He wants to become part of the revolution that overthrows society as it's today constituted. The establishment in this country, and of course, is part of a worldwide movement. I don't think any question that he was dedicated to violence. His writings clearly state that he's dedicated to violence. That he didn't intend to ever get paroled from the California prison system. He intended to escape from the California prison system.
Was he violent? Could he be violent?
Only if people were violent to him. I can be violent also, and I imagine so can you. You see, that's the whole story of America. They take their violence and turn it back around on somebody else. I don't have to talk about American violence. You can look all over the world and see American soldiers everywhere fighting in other people's countries and killing them. So if I were running the country in America, I wouldn't open my mouth about violence. As many people as they've murdered in Vietnam in the past 10 years, and they're going to talk about violence? As many black people that get killed every day in this country and nobody knows or cares, and they're going to tell me about violence? How they wiped out a whole nation of Indians, and they're going to say something to me about violence? I don't want to hear it.
I'm a black woman committed to struggle for the liberation of my people, and George Jackson is a black man committed to the struggle for the liberation of his people also.
Do revolutionaries like yourself and George Jackson have to die?
I mean, this is something that we realize as black people. It might possibly happen to any one of us, and especially if we have made it clear that we are going to continue to struggle no matter what the circumstances are. George certainly is a symbol, but he made very, very profound and very, very concrete contributions to the black liberation struggle in this country. Thousands, millions, perhaps, of people who have read his book have seen articulated in this book the frustrations and the desires that black people have had for hundreds of years in this country. So in that sense, he is not just a martyr.
George says to us, "Arise and walk. Silver and gold have I none, but in the name of that I give you what I have. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, I say, rise up and walk. In the name of Denmark Vesey of Charleston, South Carolina, I say, rise up and walk. In the name of the Reverend Nat Turner of Southampton County, Virginia, I say, rise up and walk. In the name of Frederick Douglass, in the name of W.B. Du Bois, I say, rise up and walk. In the name of my brother, Jonathan Jackson, in the name of James McLean, in the name of William Christmas, in the name of Angela Davis, and in the name of George Jackson, I say, rise up and walk."